चलिए हेलो। Friends, welcome again for this evening sessions. And now we will be having a Prasanna Kumari and women lecture on Indian women then and now. So good evening to all of you. And now before I invite our special guests for this session, I request Reverend Dr. Edwin Jabraj to lead us into opening prayer.
Let's pray. Loving God, the source of wisdom, understanding, we thank you for giving us the privilege to unite our hearts in your name, to listen to the papers that your servants have prepared. Thank you, O God, for the tireless works that our leaders accomplished in the past times. And Lord, as we remember them and honor them, and Lord, we pray that you would grant us the grace to learn new things that would challenge our lives, that we may continue to go forward in order to fulfill the vision that you gave to our former leaders. Bless all those who are here to present their papers. And Lord, help each one of us to ponder over the issues that are brought forth so that our lives will be challenged and we may continue to be a blessing to many. To that end, Lord, we commit all of us in your hands. Thank you for hearing us and blessing us. For we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Edwin. And I welcome again on behalf of our principal and Gurukul, I welcome you all. And also, Ute Pencil is here. And Dr. Meshak and family and all other dignitaries and friends, welcome. And we are so glad and very much privileged to have very prominent persons this evening to lead Prasanna Kumari Endowment Lecture. And we are so glad Dr. Aruna Jnanadasan accepted to moderate this session. And I know Dr. Aruna also for more than 3 decades. She did her doctorate in ministries in feminist theologies from the San Francisco Theological Seminary, USA. And she directed the global program on women in church and society and the justice, peace, and creation work of the World Council of Churches in Geneva, from 1991 till 2009. And she is a member of the South Church of South India. And before moving to Geneva, she headed the All India Council of Christian Women of the National Council of Churches in India. Very inspiring person, a very prominent and always for the cause of the marginalized. She's always an advocate, always speaks for the marginalized. And now she is presently a national convener of the Indian Christian Women's Movement. Welcome, Dr. Aruna. Thank you for accepting our invitation. And I also welcome Dr. Crystal David, who is also my teacher when I was in MTH. Thank you, Dr. Crystal, for accepting our invitation. And we have Reverend Dr. Limatula Long Kumar, Dean of Satri. Thank you, Dr. Limala, for accepting our invitation. Now I hand over this session to Dr. Aruna. Thank you. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Prasanna. I have been so honored by this invitation to be back at Gurukul, even if not physically. I was missing meetings in Gurukul, and I guess the 2 years of the virus saw to it that we could not meet. But it's good to be back, and I have been in the session from the morning. Excellent preparations. And I know, Prasanna, you have a lot to do with that. So congratulations for putting this day together, along, of course, with the principal. I'm very honored that I am included among all the people who have contributed to this day. We are going to focus on someone who had made a huge change in the lives of women in this country. Prasanna Kumari was not just any woman. She was quite remarkable because she had a lot of courage and was quite willing to speak out and to take a stand. And I have seen her in India, but also internationally. I have seen her at meetings where she has got up and had her say. She never feared anybody. She had the courage to speak on behalf of Indian women and to speak on behalf of all women in many situations. Of course, she has has done many things and has contributed immensely apart from getting her own studies. She has been at LSTC for some time, and she was also an amazing leader because she was active through the UELCI with slum women. So she was able to bring the experiences of the poor women into the life of theological students and to merge her vision beautifully, these two sides of her life, of being with the poor women and at the same time contributing to life of churches, to the theological college, and to UELCI. So she has an amazing capacity she had to bring all these worlds together and allow them to influence each other so well. She was a leader for women in India, of Christian women. And I have had the privilege of seeing this in action through work of the National Council of Churches in India, but mostly also through the Lutheran World Federation, where she had made a big impact in Geneva. People all respected her so much and her contributions, but also, as I said, from the smallest of the women to the most important, were all within the frame of her interests and her capacity to bring this all together. We should indeed honor her. Very few women, by the way, are honored. And therefore, Gurukul has led the way in many respects of in having this endowment lecture And this is not the first of the Prasanna Kumari Endowment Lectures, but it is one in the series. And we are very grateful as women in India, we're grateful to Gurukul for sustaining this and keeping her memory alive through reflections which are deeper than just women in the churches, as we are very often reduced to. So I am very happy to be here, to be contributing to this venture of Gurukul. And I know that my life with Gurukul will continue in many ways. So, and just one other aspect, when she set up first the Women's Studies Department and then the theology program of Gurukul with women, these were both firsts in the country. So for a theological college, Gurukul was the first to start a women's studies department and the one on theology, and particularly MTH in women's studies. I think Gurukul was definitely the first in doing that. So we owe a lot to the vision of also, of course, Dr. Rajaratnam, who was not limited in his solidarity with women. Many of us have enjoyed the encouragement and genuine concern about the lives of women in the churches that he displayed in all that he did. He contributed a lot to the ordination of women in the Lutheran churches in India, and engaged the bishops and others in a discussion about the leadership of women in our churches. So in every field, Gurukul has given us a lot, Gurukul and UELCI together. So as women of India, we are eternally grateful to you. So with that, I will request the speaker for this evening, who has also an amazing bio data. I'm already ordained her, why not? But she is Dr. Crystal David John, who has an amazing, I was reading her bio data carefully, and an amazing mix of interests and specialities. So we are lucky to have her here with us. She was former associate professor and head of department of economics at the Stella Maris College in Chennai. She was associate professor at Crinio. She contributed to the life of Crinio, before which she was also head of department of economics at the Isabella Thoburn College in Lucknow. And she was, of course, professor of the Department of Women's Studies at Gurukul, and was head of department of economics at Stella Maris College. So I saw that this mix of her theological interests and economics, in which she has studied a lot and has done much of her research, was on women and economics. She has blended these two beautifully and is therefore just perfect for to be the one who delivers this address. She has had several awards, and she has written a lot and published quite a few books and articles all over. And she has been invited as to be on a review panel of the Oxford University Press in Delhi. So that too has given her a wide range of engagements and a life which is quite full. I'm not going to say read it all because there's so much, but I feel that a person of such wide interests and commitments fits perfectly into this lecture in honor of Prasanna, because Prasanna too was a person of many interests, many specializations, many engagements in the lives of women in India in so many ways. So I think this is a very good mix of women, and I now invite the speaker to please take the floor. Wherever she is she there?
Yeah, I'm here. Thank you so much for all your kind words. And thank you, the principal of Gurukul and Prasanna and all the others in Gurukul for inviting me for this renowned person, you know, to commemorate her. Endowment lecture is really amazing because I have worked with her for about, I have had association from 1993 till about 2006 or 7. I really do not know the exact year she passed away, but I know the date, it was 16th of March. And it was such a shock to me, but I was with Gurukul from 1993 to 2000. And I first met Reverend Prasanna Kumari Samuel in Cranio in Dr. Rajaratnam's office when he introduced me to her. And I had joined Cranio because I had run off from Lucknow after the Babri Masjid riots. I was a very young person then, and it was before my marriage, and I had got a job in Cranio. And he introduced me to her, and he said that I should also teach women in the women's studies department in a theological college. Now, I'm far from theology, right? I'm from the secular world, and my subject is economics, far away from God and all that stuff. It's all to do with money. So I told him, I know, I just can't fit into this. He said, no, you will fit in beautifully because you have done women's studies. So that is how I landed in Gurukul, and it was such a shock. And he said, I will lead you along the way. And he put me under the tutelage of Dr. Prasanna Kumari. And I have learned so much from her that I will never ever forget her or her family and the association I've had with all of them and with the staff of Gurukul at that time. So as you said rightly, Dr. Aruna, that yeah, we worked at the department, the women's studies department was there, but we had to push and push and push for the theological MTH course, and it was such a big task, and she was such a big fighter. Every time any objection, she'll get up and fight, and she taught us how to fight. So, you know, we, like the staff at that time, it was Dr. Rajaratnam, Dr. Jesudas, then Dr. Devasahayam, Daniel Chetty, Dr. Mani Chako, Dr. Meshak, I don't know whom all I'm forgetting, Dr. Monica, then the women's desk, Priscilla and Vidya, you know, all of us together, so, and Dr. Rajkumar, the counseling unit, Dr. Reverend Addis Arnold, you know, he was social analysis, all of us together, we have many meetings. Dr. Gomez, he was in HR. So we had so many meetings, and finally we pushed the syllabus in MTH in UTC, in UTC at the very big meeting. And the co-committee was Dr. Prasanna Kumari, Dr. Gabriela Dietrich from TTS, and Dr. Vera Augustus from WCC, and I. And I don't know the number of fights we've had, number of arguments, number of laughs and jokes. And it was such a lovely time working in Gurukul and pushing this course through. And then, like, you know, we have had many students, both boys and girls, and I have taught many of them, like David Augustine, Anand Peacock, Prasanna, Annie, Surekha, and Smita Manoj. I don't know, there are so many. I just remember a few of them, but they are all my friends on Facebook. So anyone from Gurukul asking me to be friends, I agree. Because if I say Gurukul, I know, okay, I might have forgotten. So because it's an interdisciplinary area and intersectional area, we actually pulled in knowledge from all the departments. And that is why it has been such a difficult task to push it through. And all credit, I will give it to Reverend Prasanna Kumari, because she was a big fighter and a very big figure in, you know, actually getting it through. And it is really sad that it closed down. Like, even after I left Gurukul in 2000, I joined Stella Maris, and she said, no, you will please continue. So after my lectures in Stella Maris, I will take my bike or my car and I'll come to Gurukul, and I will take classes till 5 in the evening for the MTA students. And this went on, like, and then finally, it just, I don't know, it just closed down, and I was very, very sad about it. And I'm now very happy that the principal and the team are planning to restart this. And it will be really, really good, because, you know, women need their agency. Women need their agency to be recognized in the society and in the church. So this is very, very important. And now I've been given a very vast topic. So I have majored in on all the areas, she would tell, Reverend Prasanna Kumari will tell, you are an economist, you have to get me data, you have to get me demographic data. So when we had these summer institutes and we used to sit and work together, she'll always ask me for data. So I was just thinking about her and I brought in a lot of data and I'm bringing in the status of women through demographic profile. And therefore I have a PowerPoint and I have to do it really fast, because I'm keeping the clock in front of me and I don't want to bore you, because I don't want to go into the calculations of everything, but I just present the data to you. And so I have a PowerPoint which I have been changing till the very end, because I do not know like how to fit it in. It has been such a huge task. And I sort of sometimes regretted saying yes, because I don't fit into the stature of Reverend Prasanna Kumari, but it has been such a big honor. So if I can share the screen, Prasanna, if you can just tell me, can I share the screen?
Crystal, you want to share or you want us to share?
No, I've changed it, so I won't share it.
Oh, you want to share?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
It's disabled for me. Please able it for me.
You make it. Yeah. You can do it now. You can share it. They made you co-host, I think. Dr. Crystal?
Yeah, I'm there.
Are you able to?
I have opened it, but it's not coming on. Can you see it? Can you see it?
No.
Shall I go out and enter again then?
Otherwise, you can send it to us again.
By mail, yeah. Okay, I'll send it to you.
Yeah.
Just a minute, I'll just send it to you. I sent it. I've sent it to you, Prasanna. Have you got it? Have you got it?
Yeah, I got it. Just a few minutes.
Yeah, thank you. You can go to the next slide. I can't operate, is it? Yeah, go to the next. Okay. Actually, now I just want to tell you that I'm using the term WOMXN because I don't want a man in the woman. So basically, you know, feminists have actually evolved this term, though this also has been criticized. So in order to avoid the sequences of man and men throughout, I'm using I'm using WOMXN as pronounced as woman. So in order, it includes both trans and non-binaries and also all marginalized genders. But because the topic has been Indian women, past and present, I'm looking at it in binary terms. But please keep in mind that this binary terminology is not okay. It has to be non-binary and it has to include all the marginalized genders also. So next slide, please. Yeah, so I'm tracing it from the Indus Valley civilization. Basically, the standard status of women has been much better than it is now or it was in the Vedic period. So because you said past, I've done a very quick, you know, a kind of survey of the Indus Valley civilization, looking at the figurines, which actually depicted the status of women. And then you look at the, you know, how they have been included in the cultural and social life as the statues and the little figurines, which have shown that they have been worship of the mother goddess and Prakriti, and the whole concept of vegetation and fertility was emphasized. Next slide. And then you look at, you know, these figures which show that women were actually involved in the economy of the country. Basically, there are figures which show grinding of, you know, of the faience and kneading industries, which means that they have worked outside, not necessarily inside. They were also very mobile, as shown by this Brahmin bull, where the woman is, this was used for purposes of transportation, and women have been depicted on this. So this shows that women have been mobile and women have been working in the industry. Next. We also see that a lot of figurines have got a lot of decorations and a lot of elaborate ornamentation of the woman. It is also there in the male, but the details are extremely intricate in what has been found for the female figurines, which show that they have definitely enjoyed a greater status as compared to the male in the Harappan and the Indus Valley civilizations. Next, next slide. Yeah, even in the Vedic period, early Vedic period, women had a good status, sort of good status. They were warriors. They used to get into martial arts. They had coaching. They had training. They had education. They had, you know, they were involved in religious discourses. They participated everywhere. There was whole concept of remarriage was there for widows. There was no concept of, you know, segregating the widows and not letting her get married. There was, sati was unknown and she could leave her husband. It was not compulsory that, you know, you have to stay with a man who's persecuting you or who's harming you. The woman was very free. Now the downfall occurred in the later Vedic period, wherein you have the Aryan invasion. You have these DNA theories. I haven't included it, but you can actually read it up, which has been a lot of proof. I think Dr. Devaswamy also referred to this, of the Aryan invasion and, you know, the whole hegemony of the Brahmanical rule, which came in and distorted or, you know, polluted the beliefs of the native population, the traditional, or the, you know, the original inhabitants of the country. They brought in all these ideas of, you know, keep the woman away from education, keep the woman away from regular economic life, and the status of the daughter dropped, as in the Atharva Veda. This is the previous one. Atharva Veda actually depicts that how women are not really interested, not really, you know, kept equally as compared to men, and the daughter's birth is a disgusting thing for them. So women were discriminated against education. Next, you have the age of marriage. Next slide. The age of marriage actually was reduced, and this brought in a big problem for women because they started being, you know, depicted as a sign of beauty and chastity and stuff like this. They became pushed into as temple dancers and courtesans, and then you had the concept of practice of dowry coming in, and the dowry, which meant Sri Dhana, which is, you know, includes gifts and ornaments, properties, cash presented to a bride by her father, which then developed into Dakshina, which where the bride herself becomes the part of the booty given to the bridegroom. So over the years, we see that women are told to be calm and kind and gentle, and the whole purpose is for her to reproduce, becomes a reproducing machine, moves away from a producing machine to a reproducing machine, and her status drops. She has no decision-making powers in finance and has to just obey the orders based on the concept of Manusmriti and the Bhagavad Gita and Vedas, and all these things were actually thrust upon a very free society, where thereby women lost their status. This is the past. Just continue. Next slide. So you have, you know, I don't want to emphasize, I do emphasize about it a little later with demographic data, but basically there's been a lots and lots of atrocities against women till this date is happening, and there is no need to go into all the details in this lecture. But, you know, I remember Reverend Prasanna Kumari always, when I look at all of this data, how we pull out each and everything, and we will argue in every seminar and every forum where we can push women's rights, we will do it, and she will be the forefront fighter for this. So, you know, like I have brought in concepts of what has actually led to their status being dropped and also remaining low. So they have this, you know, the concept of the idea of exploitation of women in the society is now, with the current dispensation, it is very dangerous that women could get pushed into the concept of the status as close to the Vedic period, because, you know, this whole idea of Hindutva being pushed down our throat, even recently, you know, Fab India being attacked, then Dabur being attacked for all their advertisements, which they're bringing in all the sexism in the whole idea of their narrative of Brahmanical Hinduism. So I think that I should also advise the young students of Gurukul and also the staff of Gurukul to join Clubhouse, because if you join Clubhouse, you will notice the narrative which is coming in from the US, from the Hindutva. You have people like, you know, one Dr. Satish Sharma, he's a Britisher with a British accent. He's actually pushing the agenda of Hindutva and sitting over there telling us how to actually bring in the Brahmanical hegemony, and this will again lead to lowering of women's status much worse than what it has been in the past 10 years or 20. We are moving backwards. So now the UNICEF, you know, in spite of all of this, we see there is improvement. But what improvement? Look at the UNICEF study on gender bias in advertisement, shows that women have, this very recent 2021 study, where women viewers are looked at for only for, you know, promoting detergents and kitchen items for women viewers. And what are they depicting them as? Fair skin, very slim and very attractive, where you have got the emphasis on the body and not the mind. So the woman is again being relegated towards, you know, being the objectives object, where you have the object being looked at as a very beautiful person per se. That's all. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this, you know, this has led to the deterioration of the girl child. We don't want charity. We want justice. We are fighting for justice, and it is a fight. So you have to fight throughout. Next. Some of them are very quick slides, so you can just go to the next. Yeah, so the basic idea, and I'm bringing in this concept because this was really emphasized in Gurukul a lot when we were framing the syllabus, is the gloom over the boy, birth of a boy and that of a girl. I still remember a bishop even in Gurukul saying, oh, when I got married, this year joy, next year boy. And Prasanna Kumari Samuel was there with me, and she gave him tight. And I also joined together, and we really bullied him. I don't know who the bishop was, but this was it. So, you know, we have this idea of being, you know, this coming into the Christian faith, because the Bible itself is so patriarchal. So it's a lovely breeding ground for all this nonsense that comes in from outside, and it has got into the church, it's got into practice, caste has got into the church, you know, this whole kind of segregation of boys and girls, boys being more important, girls, the concept of dowry, all this is there in the church. So this has to be actually, you know, culled out, and therefore theological colleges play a major role, and therefore it is very important to have a women's studies department. I am not trumpeting it for sake of trumpeting it. I'm just saying it from the point of view of the future generation in the church and outside. We have to make the presence, the agency of women felt. Next one. Next slide. So you have gender bias, gender disparity, strong patriarchal society, preference for sons, sex selection, infanticide. I'm going to bring in these data to prove this. Sex ratio disparities, health outcomes show that women are really, really subjected to a lot of bias, and therefore they have their longevity is definitely less, and nutritional status. Next, please. Yeah, so the facts are vast majority of world's poor are women and girls. Women and girls, 80% of them are world refugees. 2/3 of world's illiterates are women, and millions of children are kept out of school, out of which 2/3 are girls. This is world statistics. Next, please. Yeah, every 4 to 5, for every hour, four women and girls are enter into prostitution. Three of them out of their against their will, right? Girls are subjected to child trafficking, debt bondage, forced labor, pornography, prostitution, drugs. Now, all of this has been, you know, we have data for all of this. I'm not giving you all of this data. Then you have social issues like sons are perceived as an asset, their security for old age, to they take out the family name. Sons are better for give better health care, food, schooling, 100% of them get married, have to produce an heir, and the greatest sin in India is not producing a male descendant. Next slide. Yeah, mothers breastfeed boys longer and girls for shorter time. Mothers themselves are discriminated against, like if they deliver a baby girl, they don't get that much of good food for nutrition as if they deliver a baby boy. Now, these have been studied in economics, in sociology. There's something called the gastropolitical socialization of the girl and boy child, where the girl is not fed immediately as soon as she starts crying, the infant girl, but the boy is immediately asked, the mother is immediately sent to feed the baby boy. So the baby boy grows up being impatient and the baby girl grows up being patient. And then they say, oh, girls are patient. Girls should be patient. This is known as, and it is a study by Andiyappan. And it is he's an economic sociologist. And it is, he has termed it gastropolitical socialization of the boys and girls. So these are documented data. You have nutritional and medical neglect of the girls. Daughters are not valued. They're sold or rented as factory workers, as wives, as prostitutes. If you ask me, basically, you know, women are actually... colonized. They're colonized to do work related to nurturing and housekeeping and stuff like this, so that the man can actually go out and earn a living. So this is basically division of labor. In economics, we call it the neoclassical division of labor, or the marriage as an institution of not love but a matter of money. It's basically a contract or a trade agreement that you agree into, where you are dividing labor between the man and the woman. Man doesn't have a uterus, so he cannot reproduced. Woman has a uterus, so she will reproduce. That is a neoclassical economic theory of marriage. Next one. Next slide. Okay, daughters are perceived as liability. They marry and leave their natal home and they provide labor for another family. Dowries are often paid. The girl is considered a temporary member in her parental home and an outsider in her husband's home. So she really has no place. And then there is also no public space for her because of, you know, the molestation and the eve teasing and the raping that goes on, which is so rampant. Next. This is the status even now, right? So we have 7 forms. Just quickly, fast. There are 7 forms of discrimination. Yeah, just click it, Prasuna. Malnutrition, public health, poor health, lack of education, overwork, unskilled, mistreatment, powerlessness. So under all these 7, we can analyze, and you can actually, the, you know, if you have a department, you can, each of them can be actually a research project as connected to biblical concepts. So each of them can be actually, this is what I learned in Gurukul. How can you translate this theologically? How can you connect this? How can you make Christ contextual in these areas? So if Christ lived today, how would he have handled all of this? These are the questions which we used to make MTA students actually answer in the class. So there is a huge scope for the Women's Studies department to actually analyze the, you know, the context we find ourselves in as women in the country. Next slide. Next slide. Okay, now just go a little slow here. Poverty. What are the reasons for shortage of girls in India? Now, I'm bringing in this demographic feature of how girls are being murdered in the country. What is the reason? Poverty, yes. Indian culture, yes. Illiteracy, yes. Low education level, yes. Blind belief, faith, yes. Every year, about 12 million girls are born in India. A third of these girls die in the first year of their life. Can you imagine this? And 3 million or 25% of them do not survive till their 15th birthday. This is authenticated data as given by the government of India, as underlined by the UN. And please remember, all statistical data is undercounted, which means it is much more than this, because many things are not actually reported. Then you have, you know, the action has been taken. These are the 3 main acts we have to stop the killing of the girl baby in the fetus. But in spite of all of these acts, which have been promulgated over the period of time, we have conditions. Next slide. We have the following conditions. Yeah, next slide. Next slide. Yeah, we have this. Now, what is sex ratio? Sex ratio is number of girls per 1,000 boys, or number of men per 1,000 women, number of women per 1,000 men. So you have 980, you know, you have on the x-axis, you have on the y-axis, you have the sex ratio, on the x-axis, you have the years. Now you notice that over the years, the number of women per 1,000 men have been dropping, which means women are disappearing. So Amartya Sen has written a huge text about the invisible or the disappearing woman. Where is this woman going? Like if you look at the health status, a baby boy is weaker than a baby girl, and but the baby girls die faster, which means deliberately they're being murdered. Only in 2001 there is a slight improvement. And also remember, in India, when you have average data, it is not the truth. You have to get into state-wise data. Now look at the state-wise data I've given on the side. You have Haryana, 819 girls in the age group 0 to 6, right, and 861 women in all told for Haryana per 1,000 males. So how many are missing? So if you have the average for India is 933, Haryana, Punjab, Gujarat is much lower than the national average. And this is a world phenomenon. The whole world knows about the sex ratio in India. And, you know, even countries like Pakistan are better than us. Next slide. Yeah. So now if you look at this, this is basically, I think the blue line is child sex ratio and the yellow line is overall child sex ratio. So you'll notice that overall sex ratio. So the yellow line is adults and the blue line is babies. Now babies are being murdered. You can imagine the rate is falling, though the sex ratio has improved for on an average for the country, but for the children, it is dropping, which means that in spite of all the acts and all their laws and all their legal nonsense and the trumpeting of their, you know, the mechanism for women and beti bachao and all this nonsense, we still have girls being destroyed across the country, more in the north, less in the south, more in the west, less in the northeast. So that this data is also there. Next slide. Now this is, you just look at the countries. India is the worst of the ones recorded. You will notice that China is better than us, right? India is 933, China 944. So we have 933 women per 1,000 men. They have 944. Look at Pakistan. Pakistan has got 938. We have 933. Now these are not marginal differences. These are huge differences. Look at Bangladesh, 953. We have 933. Look at Nigeria. Just look at that. Right? Poor third world countries, poorer than us, but we are killing babies and girls faster than the rest of the world. Next. Yeah. So what is the main reason? It's basically patriarchy. This refers to a social system in which men hold primary power in all spheres of life, political, moral, power, property, judicial, family, religion, media, space, right? So most societies in India are patriarchal and most patriarchal societies are patrilineal, which means the lineage goes from the male, property is inherited by the male. So the male naturally has more value than the female. Also, males are educated more, fed better, they have more capacity, they have more social capital, so they earn much more than the woman. So the woman is actually dependent and helpless. You have centuries of patriarchy in India has led to oppression of women, and this has led to female feticide. Naturally, we don't want the baby girls, right? Everybody wants baby boys. So this is the whole idea. Next slide. Yeah. So you have female infanticide. You have the first reason is gender discrimination throughout a woman's life is denied all the opportunities. She remains poorer and dependent. So nobody wants her because she's a liability. So girls cannot continue to the family lineage. Second reason, she can't continue the family lineage. The name of the family goes from the father's name, not the mother's name in most of the societies. And then you have desire for boy as an asset. And this therefore then leads to the dowry system. So it's all actually a vicious cycle of pushing women down, and the narrative that is being spread in the country today is actually taking us backwards. So I think the church has a major role. As I speak today, I think the Prime Minister is meeting the Pope. I don't know what the discussion is, but then he's meeting the Pope, right? So you have natality inequality versus mortality inequality. Ignore women, mortality inequality is that women are dying more than men. Natality inequality is that women, babies and fetuses, female, are dying faster than males. So you have ignored women to such an extent that they can die, or why bring them into the world? Kill them off in the fetus itself. So you use technology, it's known as high-tech sexism, to destroy the fetus. Even though there are laws and regulations, it is still very, very rampant, as seen by the UN data. 750,000 girls are aborted every year in India. India is shifting from mortality inequality to natality inequality. Don't even bring them into the world, just kill them off, right? Next. Yeah, so what is the prediction? In a recent research study reveals the shocking news that 6.8 million fewer girls will be born in India by 2030. The worst position is in UP. The reason is sex selective abortions, nothing else but this, right? Unlike other countries affected by such imbalances, India is unique in its regional disparity of sex ratio imbalances, because in states like Kerala, there are more females than males. The study showed that son preference is statistically significant in 9 states and union territories in India, most of them in North India and in the west of India. You have, from 2017 to 2030, UP will be cumulatively having 2 million girls missing. This is the link I have given. You can go into the study. And then you have the facility inequalities. You have women, girls being denied access to basic facilities, which are guaranteed in the constitution, like education, healthcare, nutrition. You know, I've seen this between boys in Loyola and girls in Stella. I've seen this in Tamil Nadu, supposed to be a developed state. So much of disparity is there in what the boys have as capital and as what girls have as capital, college going. Next slide. Next slide, Prasanna. Yeah. So you have age-specific mortality rates. By nature, women should have less mortality. Across the globe, women live longer and they are stronger. Baby girls are stronger. But in India, we notice that within the age group of 0 to 4, more boys are living than girls, which means this is deliberate death of murder of girls. And if the age group 20 to 24, mortality rate is very high, which means that if they survive the fetal and the childhood stage, they are given less food, and there's so much of inequality that a lot of women are dying in the age group 20 to 24. This is demographic study. Next. Yeah. So you have this reflects a lot of bias on healthcare. Nutrition kills more girls. As they grow, more girls are dying. Mortality inequality in India is found more among growing girls and than girl babies, and underlines the fact that due to health bias, right? However, age group, now this is very funny. In the age group of 45 and above, there are men who are dying faster than women, which means older men are as good as women, right? So they don't look after the older men. So in the older category above 45 years, we find men are dying faster than women, or men are dying more than women. Less than 45, girls are being murdered. Next. This is the data I've given you. 0 to 4, you see the red is female and the pink is male, right? So red is more, girls are dying more in the 0 to 4. Girls are dying much more in the 20 to 24 year age group. Then men are dying more in the 40 to 44 age group, and men are dying more in the 60 to 64 age group, which means that men are not really needed in this age group, right? And women are not needed in this age group. So you can just imagine what is happening. This is a very funny feature in India, and it is basically deliberately done. Next. Yeah, this is how long a woman lives, right? So longevity or life expectancy at birth. In 1951, Indian women lived on an average, it's all average, 32 years, right? This figure doubled to 63 in 50 years. But the hidden fact here is it is not the same across the country. When you say average, some of the high expectancy states are pushing the average up. So the low expectancy states are being hidden behind the developed states. So we notice like a Kerala woman can happily live till 75 years. That is equivalent to a Chinese, Malaysian, Thai, Filipino woman. But if you happen to be born in Bihar, then you will live 18 years less on an average. And this is current data. So current data shows that a life expectancy in some states for women is very low as compared to other states. But on an average, India has improved, and therefore, people, if you have, when you see data, you have to dig into the data. And this is what Reverend Prasanna Kumari will always say: if you state data, actually analyze the data and give me the facts. So I will analyze each of these things as an economist, and I will give her the facts. We'll sit and break our head together and then say, okay, this is what is actually happening. And you know, it was a very good learning system that we had. It was a team that we used to do, and Dr. Veera Augustus was a historian, so she will bring in the history aspect, and it was amazing learning with her. Next slide. That is the reason why I brought in this, right? So undernourishment of girls and boys, we have 75 million under malnourished children existing in the country. 75% total malnourished children are girls, right? 75% are girls, can you imagine, which is chronic and acute malnutrition. Now, you know, when we do malnutrition studies in economics, we look at the height. And we look at the height of the mother and the height of the daughter, and we look at the thickness of the skin, and we look at the, you know, the amount of food they take. So you have discriminatory feeding practices prevalent. Girls' nutrition is inferior. Boys have more access. Boys have first priority. Girls are breastfed less frequently, shorter duration, and shorter period. So if the boy is breastfed for 1 year, the girl will be breastfed for 6 months. If you have shorter duration, and in everything you see that the girls are being left out or being, you know, given a second class citizenship status. Next. Yeah, so you have 56% of girls 15 to 19 years continue to suffer from anemia. Can you imagine? More than half the percentage of girls suffer from anemia. 45% of the girls suffer from stunted growth, 20% of boys, which means boys are getting much better food, because good food means good height, right? Due to dietary deficiencies, adolescent girls do not achieve their potential height and weight. 35% of rural adolescent girls, this is today, weigh 38 kgs and a height of 145 centimeters, much less than many other third world countries, right? Micronutrient deficiencies is very common among adolescent girls. Undernourished girls also grow from become undernourished mothers, and therefore this intergenerational cycle of undernutrition goes on and on. And we have ministers who say, oh, girls are underweight, girls are short because they go on slimming diet. We have ministers who talk nonsense like this without looking at demographic data. Continue next. Yeah. Now we also have, we can go through this very fast. We have child marriage. We think it's not there. It is definitely there in states like Rajasthan. It just goes on. Next one. Next. Yeah. We have, you know, cultural practices like dowry. This is current data. 20 women die in a day in India due to harassment. Now, 2021 data compiled by the Government of India, murdered or compelled to commit suicide. I can give you the references. National Crime Bureau of India in 2017 recorded 7,000 dowry-linked deaths. This is in spite of all the legal, you know, the conditions that have been against dowry in the country. Next. Yeah, sati. Okay, now this is a practice where you shove the widow onto the funeral pyre of the dead man. So in 1829 it was banned. In 1956 it re-emerged, so it was banned again. In 1981 banned again. Right, in 1987 they passed another ordinance. Then in 1987 you have Roop Kanwar case, and now in this study, you know, in red I've given it. If you look this up, they have actually constructed a temple there, and they worship her as a goddess. This is in 2019 December, when the you know, she died in September, and they're doing this now. So this is what I'm saying. The current dispensation, instead of annulling this kind of nonsense, they are actually in their rhetoric, it's actually being practiced now. So it is very, very dangerous. And I think there is a very big role for the church over here. Like the voice of the church or the agency of women in the church is very important. So you can trace the life cycle
Excuse
of a woman.
Excuse me, Crystal, you've gone way beyond your time. There is more to come. So could you please wrap up?
Yeah, then you can just go through the slides. I'll just tell you where to stop. Prasanna, just go through, no? Prasanna? Okay, then you can jump. This is all violence. Jump
yeah.
Next.
Role
of law, yeah. Law hasn't worked. This is the current law. This hasn't worked. Continue next. I'll share the PowerPoint with you, no? You can give it to them. The Nirbhaya fund, you know, 90% of the fund not being used. Next. It's still lying unused. Can you imagine? Okay. Oh, gosh. Trace statistics. This is current data. After all those legal conditions, we have more crime against women, more crime against children. Next. Okay, this is improvement. Fertility rate has dropped. This is an improvement. And next is maternal mortality rate also has dropped. So you can go to the next. Yeah, maternal mortality rate has dropped. Then next. But labor participation rate, look at this, right? Male is much higher than female, and this is not including unorganized work, because women work, 90% of them work in unorganized labor, and it's not counted. Next. That shows their status. Yeah, next. Yeah, you can skip all of this. This is all to show the status of women. Statistically, I've given you data. That's what I've done. You can skip it all, Prasanna. I think it's done. Yeah. Please wait here. Okay. Now, India ranks 112th out of 153 countries in the Global Gender Inequality Index 2020, right? Look at the status. 2006 HDI's Human Development Index in India is 6.605. Gender Development Index is 590. It shows how much women are less developed. Then gender empowerment ratio is very dismal, 0.497. And I've given you the standard ones. And the ones who are really good is one in yellow. All these countries are much better off than us. And you have women face all these vulnerabilities, and you have the data for that. Next. This is the obvious discrimination that goes on internationally. Yeah, this is, oh, I brought in education. So in you can go to the next slide. I'll just show you how there's a huge dropout of girls from school. The dropout rate of girls from school is much more than boys, and therefore women are not getting the education that they require. So there is disparity in education also. I think this is the last. You can finish it off. I think I'm done. Yeah, this is gender enrollment. So why are they less educated? These are the reasons. And divided India. I already mentioned this, North and West, much worse off than the South and East. Here, East actually is, next slide. East actually is the Northeast. Next slide. I've given you the real states over here. So you'll find Bihar sitting on the west side. Bihar doesn't come under the Eastern category of states, but Orissa is there. So Orissa comes under the developed in these parameters. So this is the way forward. I'm done. And I've given you, like, instead of ending in a very sad note, I've given you the, go to the next. I've given you the role played by some luminaries. I have pulled out some of them, the very older ones, who have actually, you know, in conditions of real patriarchy, they have fought. So I have mentioned about six women. You can just scroll through and you can share it with the students later. So... just continue next. Yeah, there's Savitri Bai Phule, a Dalit woman who fought for them. Then you have Pandit Ramabai, the hostel is named after her in Gurukul. The next one, you have statistician and you have the doctor. So I've just mentioned all of this. Muthulakshmi Reddy, have a road after her name here. You know, she's done so much for cancer and all that. She's a doctor. And then you have Subbulakshmi. And then last of all, you have the statistician. That's it. Thank you very much. And I'm really honored that you called me to speak in Dr. Prasanna Kumari's endowment lecture. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for that very, very comprehensive and well-researched paper, which I'm sure that those who are interested in the PowerPoint will get a lot of information, etc. But the most important thing for me in all that you said is, one, that this is institutionalized and intentional, the discrimination. It's not accidental that women are the ones most affected by everything in the country, having less of everything and being the most marginalized and most ignored almost in everything. And you spoke very little about the church, but you did mention once or twice that if this is the situation, where is the role of the church? What can the church do to deal with some of these institutionalized and some even religiously sanctioned forms of discrimination in our country? So I think you have left us with a good challenge to think about the role of Gurukul maybe a future women's studies program. You even gave some ideas of what can be done and areas which there can be research, etc. So I'm sure that we can take forward the discussions and particularly your PowerPoint so that students in the college plus, I mean, people who have come, they're not only students who are here, that we can all gain from your research and putting together of these data, which can be enlightening to many people. So thank you very much. In our churches, I mean, I concentrate on people in our churches and how they can benefit from your work and what you have presented to us.
Thank you.
We have a response now. I think we will finish with the response before we go to questions. So if any of you would like to raise anything, kindly put it in the chat box so that we can ensure that a few of your concerns at least are highlighted. So let me quickly introduce to you the person who is responding. And this is Dr. Limathulai Longkumar. Limathulai, I have had the privilege of working quite closely with her on one or two projects. She's an amazing person, very hardworking and totally committed to anything she does. I think her students love her very much. I hear many of them speak about her and her role in theological education. She is the Dean of Research now at Satri and is responsible particularly for the Doctorate of Ministries and DTH programs in the Serampore Senate. She formerly taught at ETC in Jorhat and at Bishop's College in Calcutta. I know her also as being very active in our Asian Journal of Feminist Theologies, In God's Image. We have again worked together on that, and she is on the coordinating team of In God's Image, representing India. So we are very proud that we have a person of her stature over there. I have seen her also in an international setting, and she is recognized as an Asian and as a tribal feminist theologian and has made important contributions all over the world. So we're very, again, extremely grateful and lucky to have a person like her to respond to Dr. Crystal David. Over to you, Limathulai.
Thank you. I express my gratitude to Principal Dr. Sungram Basumatari and the College Authority for giving me this privilege to participate, as well as to respond to Dr. Crystal David Jong. And I really thank the, you know, college organizers for organizing such an important event of endowment lectures and Reformation Day celebration. And I am very much honored to listen to Dr. Crystal David Jones with such an immense knowledge. I just want to say, to what you have presented. And I have nothing much to respond to you. I would also like to thank Aruna, the moderator of the session, who is one of the pioneers and leading Indian woman theologian, someone I always look up to for inspiration and guidance. Thank you, Aruna. This session is, as we have been saying, that dedicated to Reverend Dr. Prasuna Kumari Samuel Endowment Lecture on the theme Women, Indian Women Then in Now, which is a very vast topic. Dr. Prasuna was a, you know, great feminist theologian and a visionary leader, and also a great advocate. Her great contributions we will always remember. Had she been alive today, how much more should have been contributed by now for the transformation of women in theological education, church, in society. Death snatched her away in her prime time. I did not get chance to closely associate with her, but her writings in her story is a living testimony for me and also for many of the women in India and elsewhere. I admire her wonderful achievements, and her legacies will be remembered and it will be with us. I would like to thank Dr. Crystal David Jones for such a wonderful presentation. You have taken us down the memory land of Indian women, her stories, women, her stories, from Indus Valley civilization up to the present status of women. After listening to your, you know, presentation, we can say that despite the advancement in technologies and many other things that the world is advancing, and even India too, women's status are getting worse and worse. And so the question is, what shall we do? It's a reality check that you have presented here. And also we can see the plight of women, the struggles, the pain that in every century that accumulated. And so we can say that how the patriarchy, the caste, and also the sexism came into the history gradually. And then it becomes institutionalized and exploited and dominated the women in every aspect. And then women are being pushed to the kitchen, and also mainly for the activities of, you know, rearing children and looking after the households. And this is what very sad thing that we can see here in this presentations. So the exploitations, discriminations of women did not happen in overnight, but it is a gradual process. And eventually it is being institutionalized in the Indian, you know, society. It went deep inside the structures, every structures of our societies, culture, religious, even political system. And this is what we can see. But despite the suppression and discriminations of women by males dominated culture, economics, politics, and so on, we can also see, you know, few outstanding women leaders in patriarchal history who brought tremendous changes. At least six of them that Dr. Crystal has brought up for our, you know, discussions and also for reflections. These are the pioneers of women's movement in India. There are also many more outstanding women leaders, even in the India's independence movement, as well as up till now. We salute those women leaders for their courageous contributions. And they are the source of inspirations for our present moment. There are many good laws, as you have already pointed out, that have come up for the welfare and also for the justice for the women in our time. But it is so sad to say that the implementation part of all this, you know, laws and regulations are, you know, still very weak, or many of the, you know, laws are not implemented at all. That is the sad part. Because most of these laws are elitist laws, and under the influence of patriarchy and ruling classes that all these laws are being formulated. I want to say that unless patriarchy, sexism, and caste are rolled out from Indian culture, injustice to women will continue. So in this juncture, there is a great role to play by the churches, as well as by the theological institutions, theological education. What kind of methods, what kind of approaches, or what kind of ministry in the church that we should develop in order to eradicate this evils in our society so that women have full liberation and transformation in our society today. Dr. Crystal also rightly mentioned about the female education and empowerment is the key to end the vicious circle of the poor status of women and foster development. But I have a big problem here. The present education system in India is still a colonial education with a white collar job oriented. Education is also more urban centered because many women, poor women, marginalized people are living in the rural India. So this education system also doesn't really help for poor women to come up. We have the empowerment programs, but these empowerment programs are also pro-capitalist in elitist perspectives of catching up and integrating in the mainstream. Do you think present education system really help? If not, what type of education in empowerment program for women in India for total transformation, particularly for the rural women in marginalized people? I want to see marginalized people, both men and women. What shall we do? This is a task ahead of us that we need to really seriously engage with it. Women then and now also refers to, you know, women's maybe feminist theology movement development in the theological institutions in the church also, that we cannot ignore it. Caste and patriarchy are deeply rooted in the church in theological educations. We have patriarchal church, males oriented theology and theological educations with males leadership in the church. The church is not better than the secular society. Maybe to some extent, I would say that from my own experience from the Northeast, the church is worse. More discriminations are there in the church too. So what shall we do in this regard? And we really thank the women's movement in India for nationalism and political freedom during the India's independence movement that also really influenced the Christian women in India. We also have the global women's movements for liberation and liberation theologies, which also influence Indian women theologians to articulate and reflect critically from a justice perspective. So from 1970s, I would say that the feminist consciousness and feminist theology in India also have emerged, which is what in the feminist movement in the world, we can see the second wave of the women's movement. India also influenced very much by that. So this is how even the feminist theology movement in India, in the church, in theological institutions also have started. So feminist theology in India is also formed out of women's experiences of struggles and pain in diverse context. Then in 1980s, particularly I think in the early part of the 1990s, we can find that Dalit women doing theology, advocated by Dalit women theologians, tribal Adivasis women doing theology by tribal women, particularly in the Northeast, and also Adivasis in the central India, have also emerged out of all these different movements. And I want to just recollect how the first conference was organized in 1984, National Conference, where drawing together over 60 women and a few men from all Christian denominations in India with the theme towards the theology of humanhood, women's perspective, which was held in Bangalore in November 1984, organized by EICCW, ATWI, and also the Catholic Women under the leadership of Aruna Nyanadasant. The outcome of this consultation was, which is, I should say, one of the first feminist theology book in India towards the theology of humanhood, women's perspective. So this is the way that we really salute Aruna Nyanadasant for his leadership in this regard. Now, Gurukul is also very important when it comes to, you know, women's movement and women's theology. Association of Theologically Trained Women of India, in short, ATWI, was formed in Gurukul Theological College way back in 1979. So it was formed at the initiation of Shanti Solomon of the Asian Church Women's Conference, and with the assistance of the Hofer of Gurukul College, Chennai, that, you know, they have initiated, and then the ATWI was, you know, formed there. So we can say that Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute is the birthplace of ATWI. We are indebted to Gurukul College for this great initiative. And as already mentioned, that women's study centers in theological colleges was also first initiated by the Gurukul Lutheran Theological College under the leadership of late Dr. Prasanna Kumari. So, you know, she really initiated, really, you know, put a lot of efforts in it in order to introduce women's studies. And she was the head of the, you know, department of this women's studies that they have initiated. And Gurukul was the first to start women's studies in MTH. And it was running very well. Then later on, UDC Bangalore also have established. And then 1996, that Eastern Theological College Johar also have established, but EGC Johar did not start the degree programs, but their emphasis was on the organizing the workshops and trainings and also publication of the feminist theology resource books, and which is they are still continuing to do. Unfortunately, Gurukul, you know, closed down the women's studies department for some times, but I'm very, very happy that they are going to start from next year. Commission visit was done already. And so I'm sure that the Senate meeting will definitely give the final approval to start the program from the next academic year, 2022. So we really encourage the college to put a lot of efforts to establish or restart this college department. The result of the feminist theology movement and also women's studies in the different colleges is the outcome of the integration of feminist theology subject in BD and MDH syllabi of the Synod of Serampore College. And now many women theologians who are doing doctorate doctoral studies are also, many of them are writing on the feminist theology topics. And that is really, you know, the outcome of all these initiatives. Though Dr. Prasanna Kumari is no longer with us physically, and we really appreciate her great visions and also the initiatives that they have done. In spite of all these achievements, I want to say that there are so many challenges and problems now for the Christian women and also feminist theologians, that there is a long way to go for us to do a lot of things. Now, when we look at one of the challenges is that women enrollment in theological education. Till now, many churches are reluctant to recommend women candidates for higher theological education studies. Forget about sponsoring, but even for recommendations and placement later on, it's a big challenge. We have a big number of women in theological education, but these are all mostly from the Northeast, mostly from Nagaland, maybe a little bit from Meghalaya and Manipur. So from the rest of the Indian, you know, churches, very few are coming because churches still have that traditional understanding of the patriarchal leaderships and structures. That's why they don't want to really recommend. Very few are coming, it's a big problem. Secondly, look at the, you know, leadership positions. Leadership models in the church are also, even including theological institution, are still male's perspective, rigid and hierarchical. This is also, we need to take the challenge how to break down this kind of rigid male structures so that we can develop the, you know, democratic system of leadership. Women's voices in theological forum these days, I feel that it is really slowing down. And I don't know the reasons why. Many Indian women are not really coming up. And this is a great challenge for my dear sisters who are here, that we need to really come up and raise our voices in many of the aspects in the churches and theological circles. Women faculty in theological education or institutions, I'm happy that many colleges are recruiting women faculty, but there are also some colleges where they never allowed to recruit women because of their church traditions and also the structures. So look at the, you know, patriarchal church traditions is really overruling against the biblical understanding and also the understanding of Ecclesia. So these are some of the, you know, challenges that we have, which together we need to really ponder upon it and then really work hard to promote justice in theological education in the church. Okay. So with that, I want to wind up. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Limatla. I was just imagining if Prasanna had been here, she would have given the speech that you gave because you spoke with that amount of passion as she would have, reminding the church about the fact that there is so much that needs to be changed in theological faculties, in the church, and where women should be honored more. So thank you very much. You have really lived up to what he would have wanted you to say and what we all as women here definitely really loved that you said. I think there was a wonderful balance between Crystal, who gave us the statistical data to prove that we need change. And you then gave the church theological challenge to support that. So you have both really, in my opinion, come beautifully together, and we're very grateful for both of you, to both of you for bringing back this challenge, which has, I haven't heard it for some time. So, well, it's the 2 years of the virus. I'm going to blame COVID for the fact that women have not been speaking out much, but hearing this has been, for me at least, very wonderful, and I think for all of us, inspiring. So thank you both, Crystal and Limala, for the beautiful way in which you have honored the memory of this great woman who we are celebrating today. I just want to add one sentence which I forgot to say. One is, of course, my gratitude to the principal of the college, not only for giving me this privilege of doing this, but also of including this in the series of lecture, sort of saying that she is as important as anyone else who has been honored today. And the theological contributions that the women's program of Gurukul has made is as important as that which has been made by the others before that. So thank you to Gurukul, thank you to the principal, thank you to Prasanna, our host Nelvala, for the wonderful way in which she has brought this all together. And thank you both who spoke this afternoon. And God bless us all. Now we will have the release of the Gurukul journal. And we have with us Dr. Giri Krishnan, who is the editor, or who will introduce the journal to us. It's something new, I think. And Dr. John Samuel, the ex-principal of Gurukul, who is here, who will receive a copy of the journal that is released. They are right there in Gurukul, so this will be a physical act of releasing the journal and it being received. So over to Prasanna, who will coordinate that. Dr. Giri Krishnan is here, the editor.
Yeah, one second. It's coming.
Wow. You have a wonderful Gurukul. We have a message from Samuel Meshak, Dr. Samuel Meshak, that he will give some of Prasanna's feminist theology books to the library because you are starting the women's studies program again. I think this is a very precious offer, which will be great for the students of the college. So if I could dare to thank you, Dr. Meshak, for making that offer. And I'm sure that many students are going to benefit from that. And thank you very much for being present in this event, Dr. Samuel Meshak. Physically present, I think. Am I right?
No, he is joining from Shillong.
Oh, okay. Oh, he's in Shillong now. Oh, yes. I forgot. He's
yes, very thank you, Arana. Thank you very much. I'm here now. I'm listening to all your contributions.
Thank you. Okay, over to whoever.
Thank you, Dr. Arana. Respected principal of Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute, Reverend Dr. Songdam Basumadharai, my dear faculty colleagues and student friends, respected moderator of the Prasanna Kumari Endowment Lecture, Dr. Aruna Ganadasan, the speaker of the session, Dr. Crystal David, the respondent, Reverend Dr. Limithulla Lankumar, and all those who are participating online in this endowment lecture. Greetings to all of you from Gurukul once again. The editorial board of Gurukul Journal of Theological Studies, along with me, Dr. Prasanna, Dr. Arvind, We are so delighted to announce that the Gurukul Journal of Theological Studies, volume 27, issue number 2 for the year 2021 is ready to be released. In fact, the first one issue was released in April this year on the day of our college graduation. Now, this journal is the result of the hard work and scholarship of Gurukul faculty colleagues and the great vision of our Gurukul leadership. In addition to involving in graduate, postgraduate, doctoral research program and all external education program, our faculty members here at Gurukul are very much research oriented, contributing to the theological world regularly. As a regular academic program of Gurukul, we have faculty student research seminar conducted every first and third weeks of every month throughout the academic year. Some of the articles are further edited and published in our journal. So in this edition, there are 6 articles and 1 book review. Reverend Dr. Wilson Palluri from Religion Department, Dr. Shanti Sudhamonika from the Nutrition Department, Reverend Dr. K. Vijayan and Reverend Dr. Vinod Silas from Missiology Department, and Reverend Dr. S. David Joseph Raj from the History of Christianity Department. All of them are from Gurukul College. In addition to that, we have also a guest article from Reverend Dr. N. Subramani contributing an Old Testament paper for publication. We are so thankful to all of them. So at this juncture, on behalf of the editorial board, may I take this opportunity to thank our friends who contributed the articles to this journal. I'm also now very, very happy that Reverend Dr. John Samuel Punnuswamy, professor in the Old Testament Department and former principal of Gurukul, to release the latest issue of Gurukul Journal. May I take this time to invite Reverend Dr. John Samuel sir to release the journal.
Moderator Dr. Aruna Jnanadasan, Principal Dr. Songram Basmatari, all the dignitaries, friends, colleagues participating online and offline. I am immensely honored and very happy to see that our next volume in the Gurukul Journal of Theology is being released today. First of all, I want to appreciate the principal for his able leadership in bringing out this scholarly edition. Also, I want to appreciate Dr. Giri, the editor of our journal. He's known for his hard work and systematic functioning. I must say that if there is one person our faculty members are a little scared of, it is Dr. Giri, because he would always insist we must bring the articles in time. And nearer the time we are going to publish, the very sight of Dr. Giri gives some kind of fear. But unless we have such commitment, we cannot bring out these kinds. And he is always insisting on the standard of publications. And every time he would encourage us to bring the highest standard. So at this juncture, I want to congratulate Dr. Giri for this great achievement of bringing this journal. Also, I appreciate all the contributors. And now, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, for the glory of God, for the better of humanity, I'm happy to release this journal. Thank you very much.
Yeah, let me just Hello, Bishop Sharma Nityanandam. Welcome, Bishop. We are derailed from time little bit, so sorry for that. And I understand you have to leave by 5:15.
Yes, yes.
That way, we will start the next session.
Yes, please.
Then now I would request our moderator, Ms. Rebecca Azariah, to lead the session. Of course, Bishop is right there. And also the respondent, I think, Chitra, Dr. Chitra is out there. So we welcome you all to this last lecture of this day. Of first copy. Oh, yeah. How to give the journal first copy online? Maybe you give to Sir one. You have given already. Yes.
அப்படி உட்கார்ந்து தான் கரெக்டா இருக்குது என் கண்ணு.
Good evening to all, the leaders of the church. Yes. I would like to thank Dr. Aruna and Dr. Crystal and Dr. Limla for such a wonderful session. I just want to emphasize once again or reiterate that women's studies as an academic discipline and as part of theological education has come a long way in the history of the Senate of Serampore College. And Prasanna Kumari played a crucial role in that process. So we are grateful to Dr. Prasanna. I just want to say that she's a very a powerful voice, very powerful, and she was a terror to the dominant and a compassionate person to the needy. When her funeral took place here, all campus, Gurukul campus, surrounded by the poor and the needy, everybody was in they were in tears. And we really lost a compassionate and a powerful person, Dr. Prasanna. And Dr. Crystal was my teacher, and also she taught my brother, MPhil at Grenio. Dr. Crystal, I still remember the unorganized sector, the organized sector, service sector, industrial sector, all those kind of things. All that teaching made a greater impact. Dr. Crystal, and your presentation today is excellent. Thank you, all three of you. And now over to next moderator, Rebecca, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I take this privilege to invite one and all for the last session on the Augustine Jayakumar Endowment Lecture. I thank our principal, Reverend Dr. Sangram Basumathari, and organizer, Reverend Dr. Nellavella Gnanaprasanna, for giving me this opportunity to moderate this session. Without wasting much of the time, I give the time to Bishop H. Sharma Nityanandam. He is the Bishop of Vellore Diocese, and he is the son of the parents who served as teachers and also catechists. He exhibits leadership skills in his service in different capacities. Being a prominent leader in the church, he will bring his rich insights of the leadership in the church then and now, and also about the leadership qualities of Reverend Dr. A.G. Augustine Jayakumar. I give the time to our bishop now.
Thank you, Rebecca. I would like to recognize the presence of Bishop Devasagayam Anna. Thank you, Anna, for attending this session. My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, it is a real pleasure and a privilege for me to be here, to be part of this Reformation Day celebrations and deliver the Augustine Jayakumar Endowment Lecture. Today marks yet another milestone in the illustrious history of the Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute. I am grateful to the leadership of the college for extending this invitation to me. Special thanks to Dr. Peter Singh, who has contacted me and requested me to be a speaker in this very important session. More significantly, today signifies yet another step in our continuing journey with our Savior in the service of humanity through the Ministry of Education. We acknowledge all that has been achieved during this uncertain and unprecedented time of pandemic has been possible through the steadfast mercy and the enabling grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. However, this grace of God has been made manifest through the committed service of many, both present staff and leadership, as well as the great cloud of witnesses like the late Reverend Dr. Augustine Jayakumar, who have made steadfast and sincere efforts to enhance the profile of the college through their academic, communitarian, and administrative involvement. At this moment in history, even as we look back in gratitude and a sense of humble satisfaction at the previous years, we also look to our future with bright hope and anticipation. In my talk today, I will explore the question, what sort of leadership does our context demand of us at a time such as this? What can we learn from leadership in the past that can be relevantly applied to leadership in the present? I want to share 5 brief points on what a leadership relevant for our times can look like today. Number 1, towards a transformative leadership that is always being reformed. Today we are gathered here also to commemorate the Reformation Day. The roots of the Reformation lay in rooting out the evils of corruption, inequality, and injustice from the life of the church. The church at that time had immense political, economic, and social influence, which it abused in the pursuit of power and wealth. What resulted was the corruption of gospel values in the life of the church, which caused numerous problems, especially for the marginalized people. It is from such a scandalous situation that the Reformation was born as a prophetic movement of reversal, repentance, and renewal. Coming from a diocese that has been shaped by the Reformed tradition, I'm reminded of a key conviction that has driven the life and witness of the Reformed churches. This is the principle of Semper Reformanda, always to be reformed. In other words, a Reformed church is true to its name only if it is always being reformed. We can claim to be reformed if you are capable of overcoming the drive inherent in all human institutions towards self-preservation and dare to reform ourselves not once in the past, but each passing moment from time to time in order to respond creatively to the challenge presented by new historical situation.
This is the challenge that I want to pose to the leadership today, even to me. How can we embrace a moral leadership in a localized world that is not only transformative, but also being continuously transformed? Secondly, towards a moral leadership with spirituality as our starting point, a transformative model of leadership that is constantly being transformed needs to have strong spiritual foundation. It is important that we speak about moral leadership, not just any leadership. Very often, leadership models in the church have become cheap, duplicate models of secular management skills, where the focus has been on prosperity, profit making, and expansion. We need to remember that there is a crucial difference between leadership and management. While management is getting things right, leadership is about doing the right things. That is the difference that our Christian faith can make. To stand for what is, which is right, to be the moral voice and vision in a context of corruption, conflict, and confusion. Sometimes doing the right thing may not be a popular option and will encounter much opposition. It is everywhere. I really, face that. That is why we need a spiritual willpower to continue steadfast in our vision. Here, our spirituality makes a big difference. It is the daily energy on which our life runs. The primary task of an effective leadership is to keep cultivating a robust spirituality. I am reminded of the words of Thomas Merton, who once wrote, I quote, "If we attempt to act and do things for others or for the world without deepening our own self-understanding, our own freedom, integrity, and capacity to love, we will not have anything to give to others. We will communicate nothing but the contagion of our own obsessions, our aggressiveness, our own ego-centered ambitions." To what extent are leaders of today, including me, deepening their spirituality as they engage in service? How are they letting the spirit of to transform their minds so that they are not conformed to the ways of the world? John Deere, a Nobel Peace Prize nominee and Christian activist, says that the context we live in can be described as the context of the anti-beatitudes. This context of the beatitudes promotes a culture which says, "Blessed are the rich and not the poor, for the reign of the world is theirs. Blessed are not those who mourn, but those who make others mourn. Blessed are not the meek, but the violent. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for injustice. Blessed are those who show no mercy. Blessed are the war makers." In such a context, it is important for us to become a community of the Beatitudes. John Deere considers the Beatitudes which throw light on the mystery of God and on God's spirituality of nonviolence as guideposts for our faith journey as a Christian activist. He warns us that if we maintain a safe distance and silence from the injustice and suffering around us, we will lose out on God's kingdom. If you bury into the logic that blessed are those who never stand up for justice, who do not rock the boat. Blessed are those who are silent to the needs of the poor, those indifferent to others' troubles, the comfortable, those who keep their distance. Then we cannot be part of God's reign of justice and peace. Our challenge today is to cultivate the spirituality of the Beatitudes and be an instrument of God's promise of life in abundance for all. Thirdly, towards a leadership rooted in justice. The key to leadership that is constantly being reformed is a model of leadership rooted in justice. Justice and only justice can make the church a credible instrument of God's grace today. Where churches and Christian institutions continue to be plagued by the sins of corruption and abuse of power, we need to name our sins, repent for them, and change our track. This needs a strong justice dimension. The call to justice is rooted in the biblical tradition. Moses is called to confront the injustice of Pharaoh. God's liberative people are called to pursue justice and only justice. Deuteronomy chapter 16:20. Amos and Micah emphasize time and again that faithful following of God mandates justice. Theirs was a difficult call to proclaim liberation and restoration, speak truth to power, and proclaim hope in the midst of hopelessness, slavery, and despair. Micah's first injunction to do justice is very important, especially in our contemporary context, where the taint of corruption hangs on our reputation and witness. We all recognize that for transformation to take place, our conviction should be translated into committed action. But we are often reluctant to act. Not often, always reluctant to act. I am reminded of the words of Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who reminds us of God's call to be change makers in this world. He says, I quote, all over this magnificent world, God calls is to extend his kingdom for shalom, peace, fullness of justice, of goodness, of compassion, of caring, of sharing, slaughter, of joy, of reconciliation, and of forgiveness. God is transfiguring the world right this very moment through us, because God believes in us and because God loves us. As we share God's love with our brothers and sisters, God's other children, there is no tyrant who can resist us, no oppression that can be hindered, no hunger that cannot be fed, no wound that cannot be healed, no hatred that cannot be turned into love, nothing that cannot be forgiven, and no dream that cannot be fulfilled. So the challenge for us has to be respond to this call and let God work through us. In the early history of the church, we find models of servant leadership that is based on distributive and restorative justice. The growth of the early church is proportional to the extent to which it eliminated inequality in its midst. We can read that in Acts chapter 2. We realize that the story of Pentecost is not the story of privatization of faith or the privatization of wealth and power. Rather, it is the story of a discipleship which is sent out to be spent out with fire in their heads, imagination, and hearts, passion. In Acts 4, we find a church that is of one heart and soul. As the apostles were blessed with great power and great grace, they establish a church where there is not even a single needy person in their midst. We see a model of leadership that involved constant living out of the gospel in a creative manner in response to changing needs. A leadership rooted in justice demands a double attentiveness, an attentiveness to the signs of the times, as well as an attentiveness to divine presence and participation in the world. This double discernment is particularly important because the dynamism and distinctiveness of any form of leadership mission today lies in its capacity to discern both the signs of the times as well as divine presence and participation in this world. Today, the model of leadership of the early church challenges us afresh. Are we willing to make space for the Spirit and be agents of God's transformative love in our context? Fourthly, towards a courageous leadership shaped by solidarity. A model leadership that will be relevant to a context of the empire, a context of deep polarization between religion and deepening gap between the rich and the poor will be shaped by a radical solidarity. We live in a context which can be called postmodern. In spite of all ambiguity, one of the contributions of postmodernity is the emphasis on the interdependence and interrelationality of all humans. From a biblical perspective also, we learn that life is interrelated and we are all God's creation. Thinking of a leadership that is futuristic, we need to take this reality of interrelated planet seriously and embrace solidarity as an important mark of leadership. According to the ethicist Sharon Welch, universal human solidarity is not a gift. It is a task. It is a way of learning and growing. It is a way of living and listening. And it is a vision of a new community in which earth is indeed fair and all its people one. I am reminded of the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, who forcefully declared, "As long as there is poverty in the world, I can never be rich. As long as diseases are rampant, I can never be healthy. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be." What this requires is our willingness to create relationships of mutuality and respect. How do we shape this solidarity today as leaders? What is needed is a leadership model of solidarity that will be shaped not by the centers of power, but by the margins, boundaries, peripheries. This is primarily a missional task for the church today. This is very important. In recent years, we have been oriented to a new paradigm of Christian mission called mission from the margins, missions from the periphery. This paradigm was born out of the Christian mission as at times been understood and practiced in ways which failed to recognize God's alignment with those consistently pushed to the margins. Therefore, mission from the margins invites the church to reimagine mission as a vocation from God's Spirit, who works for a world where the fullness of life is available for all. What is important about this new paradigm is that it does not look at the poor and the marginalized as objects of our mission, but as agents of God's mission. So it is important for Christian leaders to listen to and learn from the margins. Need of the hour, because people on the margins have agency and can often see what from the center is about view. People on the margins, living in vulnerable positions, often know what exclusionary forces are threatening their survival and can best discern urgency of their struggles. People in positions of privilege have much to learn from the daily struggles of people living in marginal conditions. Missional leadership for our times, which is not rooted in solidarity with the marginalized, is a missed opportunity because it becomes complicit with oppressive and life-denying systems. It becomes invariably aligned with the privileges of the center, fails to challenge economic, social, cultural, and political systems which have marginalized some peoples. As Dinabandhu Manchala says, if the church does not participate in the ongoing revolutionary struggles of the victims of injustice, the church will lose an opportunity to participate in the reign of God, unveiling itself among the excluded, despised people of the world. Today, as we reflect on leadership, the challenge is to reflect on how in our vision for the church and for the world, we have to decenter our perspectives and move to the marginal places where God is at work. That is not in the big churches. He has already left. We need to remember that the biggest source of liberation for Christians, which is the cross, cannot be found in the center of the city, but outside the city gates. We need to become cross-shaped Christians and get out of inspiration and vision from the crushed and crucified people in the midst of us. They are with us. Then only can the church in India rid itself of its sin of casteism, corruption, and conflict. We always talk about borderless church. Are we ready to talk about casteless church? Finally, towards a prophetic leadership for the public square. The leadership of the early church was not only one which looked after its flock. It was a community that lived beyond its walls and addressed the challenges of the world around it. It stood up against the empire and spoke truth to powers. For this, it was persecuted and ridiculed. But nevertheless, it persevered. Leadership of the church today, in a context of the unwilling excess of capitalism, religious nationalism, and conflict, needs such a public face where we address issues relating to the public square with prophetic imagination and courage. As John Wesley said, the world is our parish. In this task of building up prophetic leadership for the public square, our theological institutions have an important role, because what we are training for is not only pastors and priests, but also prophets. What we need is a public ministerial formation in India, which will produce public theologians among us, who in their varied locations, ecclesial or otherwise, feel equipped to think theologically and other theological insight, critic, guidance to the larger society regarding the global issues that we face today. We need a leadership that is existentially challenged to reorganize one's lifestyle, behavior pattern, theologies, worldviews in a radical way so that our God talk becomes more credible, contextual, and relevant. We need to critically redress the church's tendency to maintain its societal involvement from a safe distance and learn what it means to be present at the bleeding points of humanity. Intellectual excellence combined with personal integrity is the need of the hour in an increasingly fragmented world. I challenge the Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute to take up forms of theological education which are more holistic, interactive, and exciting in the years ahead. This is the time to set new directions for the future of theological education in India. Gurukul Lutheran Theological College and Research Institute was started with the motto of having a bold theological vision. To be bold is to cross boundaries, to undertake risks, and to expand the origins so that something new, innovation, courageous, and transformative is born. How are we going to do this through our ministerial formation and theological education? Are we cultivating conscious, critical, and creative leaders? Or are we producing people who pursue power, prestige, privilege, rather than following Christ? To conclude, dear sisters and brothers, leadership in our world today is mandated with the challenge of fostering conditions whereby Jesus's promise of life in all its fullness becomes possible for all. This cannot be achieved unless the entire human neighborhood enjoys the fullness of life. We are called to establish such a neighborhood. We are familiar with the theological orientation that talk both the kingdom of God as well as kingdom of God, which means a global family where everyone is a brother and sister to other. Our task for our time is to build a leadership that can work towards such a kingdom. In order to do this, we all have an important task ahead of us for the future. The task is to become communities which are both transformative and self-transforming, both responsible and responsible to engage with current challenges. To this end, my prayer is that God will enable extraordinary leaders to come out of us ordinary humans. Therefore, let us be ready to attempt great things for God, even as we expect great things from God. As humble instruments of God's grace, we are called to communicate nothing but Christ and Christ's love for all, and for what that we need to become leaders. We are both self-affirming and self-emptying. We will need to take the risk of denying ourselves in a world of capitalism, conflict, and consumerism so that Christ alone can be glorified. But at the same time, we will need to be deeply aware that Christ is the author and perfecter of our faith and therefore affirm with confidence. Now, to the one who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly or more than all we can ask or imagine to him, be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. In this model of confidence and bold humility, confidence in bold humility, may we find our meaning and motivation to life for Christ and life from Christ. May the triune God enable, equip, and empower us to develop leadership models that communicate the justice of God, the love of Christ, and the power of the Spirit. May the triune God bless us all, use us for God's purpose, will now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you. God bless.
Thank you, Bishop, for that beautiful and meaningful lecture that you have given us. To honor Reverend Dr. Augustine Jayakumar, this is the best tribute, the best paper that can be given to him as a tribute, because the 5 points of leadership that you have said can be seen in the life of Reverend Dr. Augustine Jayakumar. Thank you so much, Bishop, for this beautiful paper. Now to respond, we have a dynamic woman leader, always Dr. Augustine Jayakumar used to encourage and empower women to come up in the ministry. So we have a dynamic woman leader, Reverend Dr. Jay Chitra Lalita, who is an ordained minister of the Church of South India.
Excuse me, Rebecca.
Yes, Bishop.
I think you need to permit me to retire, because yes, I had to go for the Bishop's Council at 5:30.
Yes, Bishop.
It's almost 5:17. If you permit me, I will retire and, you know.
Yes, our principal wants
to. Okay, then on behalf
thank you.
Of the moderator.
Thank you, Principal.
Thank you so much. You can be relieved now, but I'm thankful to you for presenting such a powerful paper. As I was talking with you last night, I was just wondering, we were asking only the few draft, but you have presented excellent paper. Thank you, Bishop. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Rebecca, for the good words.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes. Now we have Reverend Dr. Jay Chitra Lalita, and she is a New Testament scholar, a strong Christian feminist theologian. She has taught in various Bible colleges, and she has served as the first woman director of the Department of Christian Education at the Church of South India Synod, Chennai. And she is currently serving as the director of Ecclesia Center at Bangalore. So she has written many books, and she has done a lot of social work among the various women groups and children at risk and people of other gender. So I give the time to Dr. Jay Chitra to give her response. Please unmute your mic. Unmute him.
A very good evening. I'll just. A very good evening to all of you. I express my sincere thanks to Rebecca for your moderating the session and your words of introduction. I remain thankful to the principal of Gurukul Theological College, Dr. Songram Basumathri, and Dr. Prasuna, a vibrant woman leader, who is a faculty colleague, I mean, to many of us who have been teaching in theological colleges. So it's really a wonderful opportunity for me to be part of this endowment lectures today. As I strongly believe in the culture of honoring the deceased persons, the ones who have lived among us and gone away, I value this opportunity to look back into their lives to see the impact they have left behind. It is not always so easy to live as a great person amidst life situations. But as we look back into their life, how they struggled through the systems of oppressions and inequality, it only inspires us to see how powerfully a life, a human life, can be used by God to impact upon other human beings for the betterment as envisioned in the biblical principles. For me, listening to Bishop Nityananda was a very good experience, I would say. Another good experience is that he is not with us to listen to my response. So I have this both privileges to listen to a church leader of his capacity and to respond to him in his absence. For the same reason, I will limit my response to 10 minutes, and it would be appropriate that we discuss this important topic. Or it has left with us a lot of difficult responses within ourselves. Bishop Nityanandam has highlighted five principles of leadership that could be a role model or a very ideal pedestal to which we can look up. However, all these five models for me sounded very healing, very consoling, comforting. As a person, as a woman clergy, as a theologian, as a feminist thinker, trapped in a system of hierarchies and inequalities. But the challenge remained to us that where we have fallen short in achieving these aspects in our churches today. For me, to start with the last point which Bishop Nityananda made, the leadership in church should be a prophetic leadership for the public square. This recalls my reading about the life of Martin Luther, who decided to make a very disturbing presence in the public sphere, disagreeing with the Roman Catholic Church leadership. He was unhappy about exploiting the resources of people for constructions, church construction, and selling indulgences to reduce one's time in purgatory. This is a great prophetic presence that we see in the life of Martin Luther. Now, today the church is not so different, and it is caught up in the evil forces of capitalism. And just to highlight how the churches responded to a COVID situation, we understand that our interest for spending money is not for those who are needy, but to ensure that it is secured for the stability and future of the church. So Martin Luther, what projected then and what we see today, hasn't changed much. I mean, the situation against which Martin Luther spoke and the situation in which we are holding these lectures is not very different. It only tells us that situations don't change drastically. The inherent nature which Bishop Nityananda mentioned remains to hold power and positions to one's own self than to spend for a better need of the church. Now, if we move to how he spoke about the interdependence and interrelationality of people. So he spoke about the solidarity. If I highlight that to a further statement as solidarity of the oppressed, a church leadership or a leadership in church should envision solidarity of the oppressed. Where do we stand, or where does the leadership direct their energy to is depending on where they or who they stand with and where they invest their energy at. Solidarity of the oppressed, I find that it is lacking in our church today because we have focused on the leadership as something that that hold the power to oneself or one particular focal point. But what we need to understand is the redistribution of power. For me, this is a very, very difficult question. We talk about the church as predominantly comprised of Dalits and tribals. If so, why do the once oppressed leadership side with the powerful and continue to oppress others? To make this complex idea simpler, I would say that if the church is predominantly of Dalits, are we talking about Dalit men? Are we talking about tribal men? If Indian church is predominantly tribal or Dalit, are we talking about predominantly Dalit and tribal men? Where do the leadership go wrong, or where does the leadership go wrong in engaging Dalit women and tribal women and indigenous women to become competent or collaborate with the fellow leaders to come to the leadership? For me, this is a very, very ongoing struggle. And this question continues to haunt me because I don't see that in my lifetime happening. Moving from there, if you see a leadership rooted in justice, I understand that human beings are fallible and no human institution can be ideal. However, all those, the opportunities that the privileged and those who are in leadership, if they could focus on bringing about a change, that would have been a wonderful situation in the Indian church today. For that, I would suggest the gap between theologizing and church leadership need to be bridged. There is a huge gap that the theologizing on the paper looks tremendously attractive. And it was so thrilling to listen to a church leader to talk about these languages. And I would definitely owe my common alma mater DTS at this time. The social justice concerns that we try to bring out on paper, are they easy to be translated into the congregations? That's where my real struggle is. That's what I wish bishops like Sharma Nityanandam to achieve that. Because what you have spoken, if you have spoken your heart out on the paper, I would wish and pray that such thoughts will be wonderfully translated into praxis in your own diocese, and that can become a challenge to other dioceses and all over the Indian church. Just to highlight a couple of points. We have that moral leadership with strong spiritual foundations. Moral, or if we can put it in a a better theological term as ethical leadership. We need people with integrity or commitment. We don't want people to just aspire to become leaders and mess up there. It's good that people who have strong ethical commitment become. The system in church should enable only those who are ethically strong to their commitment to become leaders. But we count on democracy, and democracy is all about the number, and that decides the leadership. And the same number of people will never bother about how the leadership that they brought, whether they function properly or not. And the example model, the leadership that they have chosen by their electoral rights is exactly what they are going to imitate when they come up in the positions of power and leadership. This is where we need to bring about a change. And this is where I want the congregation or every single member of the churches to be responsible to hold church leadership accountable. If you are not happy with the money that you put in the offertory as not happening properly, it is our responsibility. So when we talk about leadership, we also talk about the ethical commitment of the people who bring others into leadership positions. And finally, when we talk about the transformative leadership, for me, leadership, I go by relational leadership models, where it says it's not a position, but leadership is any action that focuses resources to create new opportunities. Leadership is a process of influence. Leaders have to create a space for people to feel being heard. It's not just making your voice heard, but creating the space for others' voice to be heard. So such proactive leaders are required for Indian church today. And the challenge that comes to us from Bishop Nityananda is that, before the challenge, the hope that was inherent in Bishop Nityananda's speech is that it is possible. It is not impossible. But the challenge that lies ahead of us is holding the church leadership responsible. And I believe theological colleges like Gurukul, like many other colleges which are closely related to churches, need to hold the church leadership accountable. And that is where the theological college's role is, because the thought processes that are happening in college campuses need to create a kind of commotion that will disturb the church leadership that is probably backing you or journeying with you or accompanying you. And that is how we can meet out to this challenge. This opportunity, I do deem as a wonderful opportunity for me to interact with the thoughts that were shared by many leaders. So I once again thank you, and I remain grateful. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jay Chitra, for that response of beautifully articulating the paper of Bishop and trying to bring relevance between the principles that he has put in his paper. And also, she has talked about praxis and solidarity, and that we could see in the life of Reverend Dr. Augustine Jayakumar, because he was always in solidarity with the people, with the Dalits, and uplifting them and such things. So thank you so much, Dr. Jay Chitra, for that response. Once again, I would like to thank Bishop and the respondent for the lecture and the response. I would like to thank our principal and the organizer for giving me this opportunity to moderate this session. I hand over the time to the organizers.
Thank you, Rebecca, ma'am, and I also thank Bishop. Yeah. And thank you. Thank you. Bishop is not here, but I express a sincere thanks for that excellent presentation, especially from church leadership. And thank you, Dr. Jayachitra, for your response. And it's once again inspiring. And thank you for your friendship. And thank you for accepting our invitation to be here. And you continue to do inspiring, continue to inspire people. And I just want to say one thing about Dr. Augustine. Is a man with a combination of different personality traits. We're so happy to remember him, and tomorrow is the second year memorial day of Dr. Augustine, a daring and a dashing personality. Of course, he's very compassionate. I just want to give one example, my own personal example, how daring he was and how power is important to bring a change. You know, my husband belongs to India Evangelical Lutheran Church, and he is a pastor, Reverend Miga. And he invited Dr. Augustine for inaugural function of his church. And it happened that there was a baptism ceremony also. At that occasion, and IELC is one among those two churches in India who don't ordain women, a very conservative church, IELC. And there were many pastors who were sitting on the dais, and IELC pastors, and I was sitting along with the congregation members. And Dr. Augustine came up and he said, now I invite Reverend Prasuna to come forward and baptize this person. There was an adult baptism on that day in the church. And these pastors were shocked. IELC don't allow women to baptize. And Reverend Miga, my husband, was also shocked. But none of them could talk anything or say even murmur against. And I baptized on that day. And that was such a, Dr. Augustine was such a daring and dashing personality, and we miss him. We need people with such a power to bring a change. And we are grateful, Gurukul is grateful to Dr. Augustine. And we are grateful to all those leaders whose lives we are celebrating today and remembering them once again, Dr. Rajaratnam, Dr. Augustine Jayakumar, Dr. Prasanna Kumari, Dr. Nirmal Mins, Dr. Arvind P. Nirmal. We are grateful, Gurukul is grateful, and we are once again challenged today. Their contributions are superb, and they made Gurukul a great blessing. So I thank all of them, and I thank our principal. And I thank our executive secretary, ULCI, Reverend A. Joshua Peter, for all the time he is very supportive, and I thank him. And I thank Reverend Dr. Chandran Paul Martin for his wonderful inaugural speech, who has set a wonderful tone for this day. And Reverend Dr. Wilson and Reverend Dr. Shanti Sudha Monica for their prayers in the morning. And all the moderators, Dr. Chandran Paul Martin and Reverend Dr. Peter Singh, Reverend Dr. Jacob Sundar Singh, Dr. Aruna Jnanadasan, and Ms. Rebecca Sreya. Thank you for such a wonderful moderation.
And I thank all the speakers of this day who have inspired us a lot and who challenged us to take a mission into a new direction. Dr. Samuel Meshach and Dr. Vati Longsha and Right Reverend Dr. V. Devasahayam and Dr. Crystal David and Right Reverend Sharma Nityanandam. Thank you very much for your wonderful lectures this today. We are very much inspired by all of you. And I also thank all the respondents, Dr. John Samuel, Dr. Nehar Zaharia Mins, Dr. Y.T. Vinay Raj, Dr. Limatullah Long Kumar, and Dr. Jai Chitra. Thank you very much for that wonderful response, very crisp, and you have given us wonderful thoughts, even remembering the leaders and setting a way to move forward. Thank you for all your responses. And also thanks to and Dr. Giri and Dr. Songram, our principal, for the release of these books. And thank you for all that hard work that you have put in. And thank you, all of you, and all those friends who have been with us and who made this program a grand success. And thanks all, thanks to all the participants and those who participated here physically and online. Thank you very much. In spite of the time differences, people from different countries participated. Thank you, Ute, for your presence, and many others, bishops, principals, and many church leaders are here. And thank you, all of you, and people who helped us, Dr. Arvind and Dr. Vinod and others, in technical issues, and all those people who are with us. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you for making this program a grand success. Thanks a lot. Yeah.
Maybe it's good to conclude with prayer. So let us all together give thanks and pray to the Lord. Gracious God, we are so thankful to you for this day. As you had inspired us, and you could plan it and bring to success and completion of these endowment lectures, O God. With thanksgiving, once again, we commit ourselves, our commitment for your ministry, particularly the theological education here in India as well as elsewhere in the world. We commit entire Gurukul, the management, faculty members, students' body, and all the staffs. Let your guiding spirit be with us as we have challenged each other this day in memory of the theologians and leaders of this institution. Lord, we pray, let the blessings from these endowment lectures follow us, O God, as we continue to envision a bold theological vision. We commit ourselves, and also we remember entire families. Be with them. And also we commit all our resource persons who have really contributed, given their time this day, with thanksgiving and all gratitude to you for your guidance. We commit ourselves once again and pray this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thank you.